Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You are once again welcome to online physics class. So, inshallah, this morning we will have the conclusive part on the topic which we have been discussing since last week, which is a fluid at rest and in motion. Now, so in the previous topic, we have discussed surface tension, angle of contact, application of those, then capillarity. Now, the other remaining aspects under fluid at rest and in motion are viscosity, classification of fluid, similarity between viscosity and friction, then application of viscosity, and then terminal speed or terminal velocity. Now, so when we refer to as viscosity, if you can still remember that when we are discussing about friction, we do refer to friction, or we define friction, or we state friction as a solid friction. That means that there is another friction that exists in another state of matter. You know, we have three states of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. So once friction occurs in solid, and we call that a solid friction, definitely there will be a friction occurring in liquid and in gas as well. So basically is that a friction that occurs in solid or in a liquid is a friction that occurs in liquid or in a gas is called viscosity. So now we now define viscosity as the internal friction between layers of liquid or gas in motion. The internal friction between a liquid or gas in motion, that is the definition of a viscosity. Now, if you take a look into some of the example of fluid we have, for example, kerosene, water, castor oil, engine oil, then syrup and the like, you will see that all these aforementioned liquids, they have different rates of flowing. That is, when you want to pour them in a container, they will get to the container not at the same time, that they will reach the container at different time. That means that there is some forces hindering or not allowing them to flow at the same rate. For example, take a look at kerosene and honey. Now, so if you want to pour that, you will see that quickly, in a very short time, water will quickly rush out and get into the container, unlike the honey. So that means that in such a case, that there is a more reluctance of a liquid to flow. That is called viscosity. That is, it causes a liquid not to flow as it is being supposed. Exactly. So now, and which is that once a liquid substances have more viscous, that is, it is more viscous, that is, it has a more viscosity, the rate of flow of that liquid is going to be very small. Unlike water, water is a liquid as well, but water has a low viscosity because water quickly gets into the container if poured. Okay, and likewise that of kerosene. So those ones that quickly move or quickly gush out of the container where they are being kept, they are said to have a low viscosity. Why those ones that, like example, honey, engine oil, has a high viscosity? So what you are saying in essence is that the reluctance of a liquid to flow is defined as a viscosity. Is that clear? Now, and basically, viscosity occurs in liquid and also occurs in gas. Is that clear? Now, in liquid, the viscosity there is due to the cohesive force between the molecules. In gases, it is due to the collision of the molecule. You will see that the liquids, they have a cohesive force, that is the force binding them together. But that of the gases, since we are also said that viscosity occurs in gases, that means that it is due to the collision of the molecules of that gas. Now, so how do we now, okay, if you want to verify, how does temperature, or what are the effects of temperature on viscosity? For example, let's take a look into honey. You will see that if you have an honey at a normal temperature, it's going to be more viscous. That is, it will possess the more thickness or more reluctance to flow. Exactly. So let's try to increase the temperature as we set that honey into fire. You will see that as it gets warms and hotter, gradually it's going to be losing the viscosity. Exactly. That means that viscosity, if you have a liquid to if a liquid possesses a high viscosity, then definitely it's going to be, if it has a more viscosity, then the rate of flow of that liquid will be slow. And likewise, that means the temperature will be lower. That means that viscosity and temperature, they are inversely proportional. Once you increase the temperature of a liquid, the viscosity decreases. Exactly. Now, that is for a liquid. Now, but for a gases, the reverse is the case. So in gases, if you increase the temperature of that gases, the viscosity also increases. So they have a separate variation of viscosity in liquid, different from that of the gas. Exactly. So in liquid, as the viscosity increases, temperature decreases. But for gases, as viscosity increases, temperature also increases. That is, in a gases, they are directly proportional to each other. I hope that is clear. Now, so since viscosity, now we denote viscosity by this symbol you can see on your screen. This something like letter C. So it is, when you see that thing, we call it that is the symbol of viscosity. And viscosity, it is being measured. Okay, the formula, it is a vector quantity. What we mean by a vector quantity is that, you know the definition of scalar quantity. There are some quantity that they only have magnitude. That is, they do not have direction. So in such a quantity are called scalar. Then those quantity that has both they have the direction, and then they also has the mass, that is the magnitude. They are called a vector quantity. So now, mathematically, we can define viscosity as the force over area then times velocity gradient. So viscosity is given as C, that symbol, equals to the force over area then times velocity gradient. Now, so we want to derive the formula for viscosity. You know, the SI unit of force is a newton. So we have newton here. Now, the SI unit of area is a meter square. Now, so velocity gradient. Now, whenever you add a velocity gradient, what it means is that the main word there, which is the velocity. The velocity now, what is the formula? So whatever you have for velocity, then divided by the length, we give you, that is the meaning or the interpretation of a velocity gradient. Also, for example, if you have, or you add up temperature gradient, it will be temperature over length. So anything over length is called that the gradient of that term. As you have a velocity gradient now, it will not be the formula for velocity or the unit of velocity divided by length. So the unit for velocity is a meter per seconds. Exactly. So meter per second. And so since it is velocity gradient, that gradient is also divided by length, now be over length again. Exactly. So now from here, you can now say that this will give us n, then okay, this also the unit is meter, nm over over m squared times m, this equal m raised to power 3, then per seconds. I hope that is clear now. So from here now, if 1m reduces 1, you're making becoming 2. So we now have n meter square then per seconds. So if this part goes up, it will now be, I hope you can see. Okay, so it will now be that we will now have, we will now have n seconds over meter square. So which is n m square then x, like this. So here now we can now say that the unit is a newton second per meter square. Newton seconds per meter square. Also, here you know that newton per meter square, that is for prayer over here. So we can also say the unit is a pascal then dot seconds. So any of these units can be used to relate the unit of viscosity. It can be given as a newton second per meter square or pascal dot seconds. So that is that for the unit of the viscosity. Also, some liquid are more viscous than the other, so that once you see a liquid that is more thick, so that means that such a liquid possesses is more viscous than the rest. Okay, now so if you want to classify a fluid now, since we have known that a fluid is being reversed for anything as liquid or gaseous substances, so now we have some liquid that the frictional force there is low, that is the opposing or the reluctancy of that liquid to flow is low. So such a liquid now, so we now define them as a low viscosity or low viscous fluid. So example of such are water, kerosene, petrol, ethanol and the likes. Also we have some liquid as well in which that the frictional force existing between the molecules, between the cohesive force, is very large. So does such a liquid are called high viscous liquid. An example of such are glue, syrup, grease, glycerin, engine oil and the like. So if you compare this, we can say that we have two types of liquid. We have the low viscous liquid and then high viscous liquid. So since we have defined a viscosity as the internal friction between layers of liquid or gas in motion, definitely we will also check the effect of viscosity, so among, and then the similarity, but in the next slide. So here now, the viscosity is responsible for the different rate of flow of fluid. You will see that many fluids, they have the different rate of flow which is different. So also it affects motion of an object. For example, you will see that if you have an object flowing on water, or try to, it want to sink inside water, and that of the engine oil, you will see that the rate at which that object will sink or flow will be different, because the viscosity of that liquid different from each other. Is that clear? Now then also let's look into the similarity between viscosity and friction. Since one is a solid friction while one is a liquid or gaseous friction, so that of solid friction is called the normal friction while the other one is called viscosity, and you have seen the SI unit and the rest. Now you will see that both from what you have done in the first time under friction is that it depends on the nature of that surface. If you have a surface that is more rough, definitely the frictional force existing between the layers will be more, since the surface is rough. Exactly. So we can answer that friction depends on the nature of that material, and likewise viscosity also does that. So that means that surface of water now is different from the surface of the castor oil or engine oil. So also both opposes motion between surfaces. It's opposing. If an object wants to flow, it will be reducing or try to repel the motion of that object. That is, if an object is trying to flow through the liquid, it will be trying to be reversing the direction or the motion of that object. So also, let's look into the differences between friction and viscosity. We have stated that friction depend on the nature of surfaces in contact, and likewise that viscosity. But friction does not depend on the relative velocity. I will prove this one for you when we get to terminal velocity. So this one depend on the normal reaction. And then the other one is that, so this one, it does not depend, it depends on the relative velocity between the layers. And then friction occurs, you can see that these points 1 and point 2, they are interchanged, right? So it depends on normal reaction. Is the opposite is that does not depend on the normal reaction. So this one, it occurs in a solid, while that of viscosity occurs in liquid. I hope that is clear. Then what are the applications of viscosity? You will see that majority of what I've mentioned, that is those that have high viscosity, they are a good lubricant. They possesses they are used to softening the metal part that are in contact. So we use them viscosity fluid, they are used as a lubricant, that is to reduce the friction existing in machine. Then also you will see our paint. You will see that the paint is not as that of exact water. Once you buy your paint, you try to mix it with little water, right? So that to soften into a little bit. So that means that to make it to have appropriate viscosity. So if the viscosity, that means that viscosity is also used in the painting industry. So if you want to start painting now, or you want to venture into painting industry, that is production of paint and the likes, so you use the application of viscosity extensively. You have to know the appropriate viscosity of some fluid that you want to produce, so that it will give you the desired design that you want. So it is used in the painting industry. Likewise, writing ink like the biro, the ink inside the biro is not exactly as water. So that if it does not have an appropriate viscosity, you will see that if it is water that is being poured exactly inside the ink, inside the nib of that pen, everything will just move out as well. That means, well, you know, water is very less viscous. So the ink has to possess an appropriate viscosity before it can be used very well while writing. Okay, so these are some of the application of viscosity. Now, so let us now discuss about terminal speed and so we want to discuss about terminal speed or terminal velocity. Let's take a look into an experiment you have on your screen. You can see a liquid. That liquid can be any of a viscous liquid, such as we use engine oil or glycerin. Now, when you have a small bearing, like a pendulum bulb, that you throw on the surface of that honey, you will see that as you have it, once a small ball bearing is being dropped on the surface of the honey or a viscous liquid. Now, the ball will be that it should quickly rush down to the bottom of the container. But the upthrust force, which is called the upward fellow force, which is called Okay, now once you have a bulb on this surface like this, it will be affected by three forces. One is the upward force, that is, it will be preventing that this small bottle sink. Then likewise, the viscosity of this of the fluid, you know, the liquid have their viscosity, right? Now, and then the weight of this ball which acts downward, it will seem that as you throw this ball inside the container, it should quickly rush down to the bottom of the container. So now, if you now have, you know that from the knowledge of our resistance, you can see that U and V, they act in the same direction. That is, they are the ones who move the ball bearing upward now. So that means that they are in the same direction. So once you have two forces in the same direction, their resultant will be addition of the each of the forces. So we will now say that R equals to, that is the resultant of this one and this one, equals to U plus V. U plus V. Now, then, so that means that once we have gotten a resultant here, that means that we now have one forces here now. So if you now compare it with the weight of that bearing, so that means that the two forces again now, they are now in the opposite direction. So and then once you have two forces acting in opposite direction, the resultant will be that of the larger one minus that of the lesser one. So we now have the resultant equals to weight minus that of the initial R we have gotten, minus that of the initial R we have gotten. So now, if you now substitute, you know that the mass equals to mv, so mg. So we now have mg minus our R, which is summation of V, and we now say that minus in the bracket V plus U. So if you open that bracket with minus, so with, and then resultant equals to ma, as from the Newton second law of motion, F equals to ma. Newton second law of motion state that F equals to ma. So now, if you can see that if we substitute weight as mg, we open the bracket with minus into bracket V minus U, that means that we have mg minus V minus U equals to ma, or we say that weight minus V minus U equals to ma, right? Now, so as you have this one now, if at a point that the thing is not accelerating again, we now let that go, let's aim A to be zero. That means that this one is zero. Therefore, we can now have that mg minus v minus u equals to zero. So from this, the first equation, if we make v the subject of the formula, so we can say that v equals to mg minus u. Exactly, mg minus u. So now, and at a certain stage where the ball ceases to accelerate, but it's now moving with a constant or a uniform velocity, that is the equal velocity, equal speed, or equal displacement is covered in an equal interval of time. So such a time now, we have such a speed that is moving is called a terminal velocity. That is, a terminal velocity can be defined as the velocity at which an object or a particle accelerates with a uniform velocity. A terminal velocity or terminal speed is defined as a velocity or a speed at which an object accelerates with a uniform velocity, that is, equal displacement is covered in an equal interval of time. So such a case is now, we now say that okay, the viscosity is directly proportional to the terminal velocity. Viscosity is directly proportional to viscosity. So U equals to KV. U equals to KV. So we have U equals to KV. And this is not V. This is U equals to KV. We have K equals to the, you know that K is the proportionality constant. And then that our V is the drag, or which is called the terminal velocity. So u equals to av. That is what that state now. And then if you look into the diagram of the velocity time graph for a terminal speed or terminal velocity, so as you have it here, you can see that once the bulb starts to move with a constant velocity, that is OTY, once will be moving on a straight path, so that point is called a terminal velocity. Exactly. So initially it will start to accelerate until it stop accelerating, then moving with a constant velocity. So at such a point, it is at such velocity that is called a terminal velocity. So we define a terminal velocity or terminal speed as its velocity or a speed at which a particle moves or an object moves with a uniform velocity. Exactly. Also, then master the equation very well. Mg, v equals to the viscous force, then equals to mg, which is the mass times the acceleration due to gravity, then equals to g, or you use weight minus v minus u equals to ma. And a from that side, our a equals to the acceleration of the ball bearing, yg equals to acceleration due to gravity, and that one can be 10 or 9.8 as it is being given. Now let's look into the viscosity of some liquids. Now, so one example is that as we have water at 0 degree, you will see that the temperature and the viscosity is a 1.7 exponential minus 3. So once we have a temperature at 20 degrees, so once we increase the temperature, as I have earlier stated, once we increase the temperature for a liquid, the viscosity will decrease. So here now you can see, when the water is at 0 degrees Celsius, greater than when it is at 20 degrees, and likewise when it is at 80. So, and then engine oil at 30 degrees Celsius, it is, the value is 200 exponential minus 3. Then human body, you know that the blood as well, it is a viscous liquid, right? So, and the value, and at normal temperature, 37 degrees Celsius, the value is estimated at 0.8 exponential minus 3. So, all these values are a constant. So, it is from the experiment they got all these values, okay? Now, so this is the table giving us the viscosity of some liquid. So, this is where we will be stopping for fluid at rest and in motion. So when next I come your way, we start with another new topic. So, but before then, let's quickly see what we have discovered in this lecture. So we have been able to see or define viscosity and those liquid that has less, that are less viscous, and those that are more viscous, and likewise the definition, the formula, and the likes. Okay, so your assignment will be inclusive in the notes I will be sending to you. So get your assignment from the notes, and also you should reply the assignment, that is, give a response or the solution to the assignment. So till next I come your way, I am your Malam Abdulwahid. So I wish you stay safe at home. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.